I had a really terrifying nightmare this morning that involved my fridge having sort of a false back, sort of like, you know how Dio has a second coffin underneath his coffin or whatever, like a false bottom. So too did my fridge have a false back, and it was actually a door into my neighbor's apartment. Now, it just so happened to be the case in the stream that my neighbor was actually a very good friend of mine. I'm very fond of her. She's very good-natured and attractive and intelligent. And so you'd think, hey, this is actually a pretty good scenario. Except it turns out she was a vampire or a cannibal, one of the two. It was kind of hard to be sure when she was stalking me around her own apartment with blood flecks across her face and caught in her springy, bouncy, curly black hair, holding also a blood-stained meat cleaver, saying, "You know, this is a lot easier to use if you're not running away. So why don't you just stand still?" Oh my God, absolutely terrifying. And so I was hiding in all sorts of creepy places, trying to not get caught by a friend who I actually am really fond of. It was maybe one of the strangest experiences I've ever had. Eventually, I managed to sneak back through the fridge, and opening a fridge without getting someone's attention is pretty difficult because, you know, usually the other person is hungry as well, so they'll try and get you to feed stuff from the fridge as well. But in this case, the person who was hungry was trying to eat me rather than anything that was in the fridge. If you're ever in this situation where you're being chased by a vampire and you need to get away by sneaking through a fridge, what my dream self ended up doing, and I think this is a very cool situation, is he padlocked the fridge from inside. I'm not sure how that works, but that's what I did. I think that was a very ingenious solution, and I'm proud of my dream self for being able to do that. Shortly afterwards, though, within the fridge and on all fours, kind of like crawling back to my apartment, the vampire found me, my friend found me, and so she started rattling the fridge door like mad. And so I was really glad that I padlocked the fridge in that scenario. But then at that moment, I woke up because the fear, the adrenaline of realizing that the vampire is right on the other side of this fridge door woke me up, and I got the chance to think, what kind of vampire can't just break a lock through sheer strength, right? And so that's when I started realizing maybe she wasn't a vampire, maybe she was a cannibal after all. But on the other hand, I do have this headcanon that the lock was made out of silver. And that's how the silver weakness for vampires works, right? It's just anything made out of silver, they can't do anything against, I think. I haven't played Resident Evil 8 Village, but as far as I know, that is pretty much the story of Resident Evil 8 Village. So I guess I save money in not having to buy that game, just because now I have this very traumatic dream that I can live through. The other thing about waking up from this dream was I realized I hadn't talked to this particular friend in about 4 years. I guess that means we're not really friends anymore. And even if I tried sort of resuscitating that friendship, it would be extremely awkward to say, "Hey, I had this dream where you were a cannibal and you almost ate me." I guess it would be on brand because I'm not very good with social scenarios. All this is to say that I have had it up to goddamn here with vampires, and damn it, I just want a little bit of a break. I've been reading George Joestar, obviously. I've been reading Over Heaven. The new Ed Sheeran song came out, and that had vampires in the music video. It's vampire overload, damn it. I just want a break. I want a break, and my brain is telling me, do whatever it takes. Crawl through a fridge if you have to. Just get away from all the vampire business. So I'm really excited to be finishing Over Heaven in that light. Of course, we have only one more chapter release, one more video before the journey is done. So I hope you guys are as excited as I am for that. One quick little note before I jump into the commentary proper is that my window is currently open. It's been hot as shit for the past week, and I have done zero work for the YouTube channel. You know, I recorded a new chapter of George Joestar, and it was supposed to come out today, but I just haven't had the time to edit it and to render the video just because it's been so hot that literally can't even turn my computer on because it is a source of heat, and it would only just make the situation so much worse. For the first time in a week, it's finally cooled down. I mean, on the other hand, it is raining and it is getting actually kind of chilly, but honestly, I don't care. My window is wide open, my door is wide open, my heart is wide open, everything is wide open, and I'm just having a blast recording this. It does mean, however, that because my window is open, you might hear thunder, or you might hear bird song, or you might hear a dog barking, or you might hear children playing, etc., etc. Honestly, I don't care. I just like the fact that it is not hot at the moment, and I'm just glad to be finally relaxed and chill. So, With all that out of the way, these commentary videos are more and more just becoming vlogs as I record more of them. I mean, we've talked about dreams and then we talked about the weather, so this is the high quality content that you can expect from my channel. I guess over the course of this video, you can also expect like a face reveal. I'll show you my ab workout routine. Maybe I'll do a guided tour of my new apartment. That's something that vloggers do, right? I can take you down to the new frozen yogurt place that just opened up a couple of blocks away. In fact, that's the only reason I moved to the new apartment, for easy froyo access. I can do a makeup session. What else do vloggers do? I don't know. Maybe I'll play another cover of a Taylor Swift song, for those of you who enjoyed that from my Guild Wars 2 video. I guess I could try cooking, you know. I'll try making my favorite dessert recipes or something like that. Who knows? We'll see. We'll see what the video has in store as I become progressively more and more just another YouTube vlogger, I guess. Let's jump into the actual commentary, finally. First thing is, of course, Dio as a character. We see such a strange aspect of his character taking hold of him. Maybe this is Nisio Isin writing as more of a character writer. We see in his work, such as the Monogatari series, that he's always thinking about the inner monologue of a character and why they're motivated to do certain things in a certain way, or how they come to see different characters in different situations. And I think that focus on character writing is really cemented in Dio here specifically, because a lot of conflicts of characters start emerging within him. In the earlier commentaries, I kept mentioning that Dio is a person who's very much focused on action, right? He thinks that evil people have greater strength than good people because there's fewer things holding back an evil person's ability to act, whereas good people have, for example, virtue. Or else cowardice masking itself as virtue. For Dio, that places people who act as sort of higher than people who choose not to act or who lack the forthrightness, the courage to act. Action becomes paramount. But Dio, we see here, he withdraws away from the world, so to speak. He withdraws away from action instead of pushing out and being there, for example, in the lobby when the Stardust Crusaders arrive. You know, I've been really excited to say the Stardust Crusaders because Dio, in this particular novel, keeps saying the Joestar group, the Joestars, rather than actually using the name by which we know this particular band of adventurers. Anyway, so when the Stardust Crusaders arrive at the lobby, he lets his butler, he lets Terence T. Darby take care of it. Instead, he lets Kenny G take care of it and Vanilla Ice. He himself is, you know, even though they're in his home, like this is the moment when he should be fighting with all the strength he has. He says, guess I'll take a nap. I'm not too worried about that right now. Or, you know, he spends, it seems, all of his time just writing in this diary and thinking about his past. You know, he even entertains this hypothetical scenario where he fantasizes about joining the Joestars, about helping Holly Cujo recover, about telling Jotaro and Joseph that, hey, I can help you guys, by the way, I can heal Holly, and we can figure this heaven thing out together. It's a lot of wishful thinking, and in fact, he even fantasizes about going back in the past and just keeping that mask on of being the quote-unquote normal Dio, right? Remaining Dio Joestar for the rest of his life. And I think that is a very twisted thing for Dio to think, considering where he's come from and all the things that he's revealed about his past and why it was so important to him to have claimed this new identity of Dio. At this point, he's gotten so desperate that he's willing to discard all of that so that he doesn't have to face up to the threat of the Joestars that are now in his home. I think Nisio Isin as a character writer really sort of pulls this 180, let's say, from Dio at the start to Dio here now. Only 6 entries and only, let's say, a couple of hours away from his ultimate conflict with the Joestars. I think this is Nisio Isin trying to create this interesting perspective on a narcissist, right? Someone who is completely self-involved. You would expect pride and that arrogance that I've talked so much about with Dio to persist and in fact to multiply as his enemies find their way to his home. And in a way, you know, it is a representation of his pride that he can say, oh, I'll beat them anyway. It doesn't matter that everyone, all of my allies are dead. I can disregard that fact. I'll beat them nonetheless because my stand the world is just that amazing. that is a pride to a certain degree. But what I mean when I talk about Nisio Isin doing this 180 is sort of this other sense of pride where you're supposed to have a certain identity, right? You're supposed to have something that you can hold on to. And usually that's your past. Those are the things you've done. And you have pride in those things you've done. But Dio is such this confused mess of different identities. Whether it's Dio Brando going into Dio Joestar, going into Dio the Vampire from part one, going into Dio the newly recovered from the bottom of the ocean, weak and reliant upon this mother figure, let's say, of Enya the Hag, his own divine mother, as it were, to Dio as we see him today. I think he is such a confused and fractured mess of these different identities that he can look back on any of them and say, maybe this was better than where I am now. Or, you know, rationally convince himself that in fact the past was so much better than where I am now. And that is not really a trait of a narcissist so much as I would say a nihilist. You know, someone who cannot gaze upon the here and the now and find meaning and find an identity and find a place, cannot look to the future and derive, you know, some sort of path that says, oh, well, I want to get here and this is the journey that I have to take, right? Like for someone who's so focused on the future as Dio has become through his new interpretation of heaven, which I'll get to talking about, he can't actually synthesize a path from where he is to where he ought to be going in the future. And I think one consequence of that is that he is completely absorbed by the past. He loves himself as a narcissist does, but he loves only his past. The price of that, of always looking at the past, is that when he sees the future, you know, his dream that heaven is a future that you know and have resolve for, he does not actually have the ability to synthesize that for himself, which is why he has to turn to Pucci. He doesn't have faith in himself as the person who could generate that heaven. Even though he has the power, he doesn't have the mentality. He doesn't have the spirit. He doesn't have the stand, I guess, something like that. Which is why, of course, he ultimately decides that the stand that he has, the ability to stop time, is insufficient for heaven. And that's sort of a metaphorical way of saying the same thing that I am, which is what writing is designed for, right? To speak in metaphor. One extra note that I quickly want to slap onto Pucci is we see in these past few entries that Dio literally begs Pucci, you know, being in that weak position where he realizes the stand he has is insufficient. Versus, you know, he sees Whitesnake and he realizes the only stand that can use souls is Whitesnake. And in fact, he also points out the only other stand that has illusions is Whitesnake. It seems like Whitesnake is the amazing replacement stand for everything that he's currently losing. And so he's also pinning his hopes that Whitesnake will become the stand that can grant him heaven. And we see something, you know, this is a further reflection on this idea that Nisio Isin is doing a 180 with Dio's narcissism. Dio literally begs Pucci to finish the plan if Dio himself cannot. And that requires a certain humility on Dio's part. Again, you don't expect Dio to ever have had. I guess there's two ways of looking at this. One is Nisio Isin writing as a character writer and trying to create this unique perspective of a narcissist. But there's also the fact that Dio, you know, he really does go through quite a significant change from part 3 to part 6, just from Araki's perspective, just from the core JoJo's Bizarre Adventure stories. And you have to wonder how much of it is Nisio Isin just trying to thread those two disparate Dios together into one cohesive character. But I don't think that's really the case. You've seen Dio, we've seen, I guess, as we've listened to this audiobook, Dio growing more and more into someone who recognizes how pathetic his abilities are, so to speak. All he, you know, he has to look to children like Boingo, which is a really cool other detail, by the way. And he has to look at other stands that have much greater power, the ability to trap souls. And he acknowledges multiple times that he would lose probably to other stands very easily, even if he thinks that the world is the best, the strongest stand out there. We've seen him grow in humility as the scope of heaven becomes ever more paramount. As he recognizes, this is another phrase that Dio says quite often, as he recognizes that victory doesn't really come to someone who has the greatest will or the greatest stand power, but rather victory goes to he who gazes upon heaven, which is a very sublime thing to say, I suppose. It's a very restrained thing for a megalomaniacal vampire at the top of the food chain to be saying. And I think his ability to beg Pucci, or just the reader of the book, to say, listen, I have something that is even more profound than my life, and I think I don't have the ability to fulfill it, so please, I'm begging you. I'm kneeling down at your feet and desiring nothing more of my life than to ask you to fulfill this for me. If you guys have seen Hunter x Hunter, then maybe you can recall a particular scene that evokes that very same imagery. But I'm not going to go into any spoilers. I'm just going to throw that out there for those of you who have seen Hunter x Hunter. I think that is the fulfillment of the complete switch that Nisio Isin writes for Dio. I'm not sure if I fully fleshed out this thought, but I think it is an interesting perspective on a narcissist that Nisio Isin is writing here with Dio. And I guess really this is the motif of Over Heaven, is someone who keeps saying, I need to find some path to heaven, right? He's trying to create that bridge from the present to the future, but all he can do is look at the past. He's anchored to the past. He cannot find the journey onwards. Moving on from Dio as a character, I wanted to talk a bit more about the structure of the story. You know, I did mention that there's sort of a triumvirate or a trinity of interweaving parts. You know, there's the Dio from part one, where he's, of course, reflecting on his past, how he lost to Jonathan, and why it's not so much Hamon that he lost to, but rather gravity or fate or meetings, right? These are all sort of interconnected ideas to him, and he's been parsing them out, as it were. He's, of course, been talking about the events of part three, because those are the present. And, of course, you know, obviously part six is relevant. So there's these three different Dios being integrated together into single parts. And the intent, of course, is that Nisio Isin is trying to create this Dio's bizarre adventure kind of narrative. And I'm going to talk about that more in the afterword. I think it is a very interesting idea. Whether it actually succeeded or not, I'll talk about that in another video. What I really wanted to say is that for now, the parts one and three elements are feeling more and more like they're just being recapped for the sake of completion rather than actually writing about anything important or specific. There was one time where that was not the case, and of course that was Jonathan's Watch, like I mentioned, which is a manga-only thing. But for those of you who didn't recognize that little element of the story of Phantom Blood, that's a manga-only thing. Dio comes into Jonathan's room while he's crying, steals a watch and says, hey, Jonathan, I'm borrowing this, more or less. And while I think it is a bit of a reach to say that that's when Dio's stand, the world, was decided, it was used, I think, very effectively as a transitionary point to introduce this idea that the world isn't enough, like I've said before. And you know, it's very interesting that Nisio Isin points out that a stand that can only stop time isn't enough to control time, right? Even though pausing time is an aspect of manipulating time, it's not really... Let me explain it by comparing it to every other main boss stand, right? So Kira's stand has the ability to rewind time, but what does Kira do by rewinding time? He has foreknowledge of those events. And also, the people who he's killed in the earlier timelines die all the same, even without Kira's interference. And so what that means is the future is changed when Kira learns about the future. What about Diavolo? Diavolo has epitaph, right? Yeah, confusion will be my epitaph. All right. Can't believe I just did that. Oh my god. Diavolo has epitaph as a secondary stand. What does that do? That allows him to gain foreknowledge of the future and change it within the 10 seconds that will pass. Okay, what does part 6 do? Actually, something a little bit different. A Maid in Heaven gives everyone foreknowledge, not just Pucci. It is unbiased in giving everyone knowledge of the future because of this perception that knowing the future will let you have resolve for it, even for those elements that are displeasing to you, or rather, especially to those elements that are displeasing to you, like your death, like the death of a loved one. In that context, I think it is very interesting, in that broader JoJo's Bizarre Adventure context, it is very interesting that Dio, the one person who, it turns out, sought heaven, right, and sought this sort of egalitarian perspective of heaven, and I'll talk about that more when I talk about him discussing Undul, calling him the messiah of evil. Dio was the one who never really got that combo power, right, where you can look into the future and then manipulate the flow of time itself. Either to avoid that someone just sneezed super loudly. Hopefully you didn't catch that. the threat of open windows. Either you change it so that you benefit from the new timeline, as it were, for Kira and Diavolo, or you simply accept the flow of time the way that Boingo's stand does, the way that Made in Heaven does. You could also draw a parallel with Ringo's stand from Part 7, although that's such a technical stand that I don't really want to get into it, so let's just sort of steamroll ahead. Although Part 1 and Part 3 are just being recapped, beat by beat, what Nisio Isin had to do with Part 6 was sort of integrate ideas from Part 6 and the, you know, the theological aspects and the time-gravity aspects. Those ideas in Part 6 really needed to be baked in a realistic manner. Whether it does that remains to be seen. Obviously, we still have some of the book to go. And how much of it is also just sort of engineered by Nisio Isin? So, for example, Dio has this little thought experiment where he says, what if every soul could be enumerated through 10 chips, and the color of those chips shows how good or evil the souls are? I don't quite recall if that was from Part 6 specifically, or whether Nisio Isin is introducing this concept ad hoc. I think it's an interesting concept all the same, although the, you know, 10 black chips times 36 sinners gives us 360, which is a full circle. That seems kind of contrived. It was very cool to read through that and be like, oh, I see, so that's how you're setting up the, you know, the revolution of the universe thing. It was cool to see that set up, but also at the same time, it was very obviously contrived. And those are the moments where you stop reading the text in more of an analytic way. For example, the way that I was talking about Dio as a narcissist, that's an analytic way. This, with the 10 times 36, this is more of just a, I have to read this as a JoJo fan, reading the work of another JoJo fan, trying to sort of reverse engineer Araki's bizarre logic. And it doesn't always work. I think this is one of the cases where it doesn't work, but it was fun to read all the same. One of the cases where it does work was in Dio quickly mentioning that he wants to find heaven for the sake of sinners like Undul, who are discarded by humanity simply for being different, right? And that's very egalitarian of Dio. I didn't expect Dio to really be a social justice warrior, but who am I to judge? But I think it's a bit more distinct. I think what Dio is trying to say is he's trying to answer the question of why do people fall away from the world? Why do people fall away from people and society? How can people be disillusioned from goodness, right? Why do they have 10 black chips to begin with when they could just as easily have had 10 white chips like Jonathan Joestar? And looking back at his own past, I think Dio has realized it's probably because they feel betrayed by the world. They feel like the idea of deserving something doesn't actually have any value, which is why Dio sort of labels himself a taker. He doesn't believe in deserving things. He isn't an inheritor. And to him, the distinction is arbitrary. Not so much that the distinction doesn't exist, because it definitely does. To Dio, it definitely does. But rather, who is chosen as an inheritor is completely arbitrary. It is for the sake of the people who are not chosen that Dio wants to create a path to heaven. Because for the other people, you know, it's easy as hell, so to speak, to get into heaven. You know, we talked previously about how George Joestar very easily could have gotten into heaven. And if he didn't get to heaven, then what is the deciding factor? Luck? Really? We're leaving something as profound as our ability to go to heaven, to sanctify our souls, to luck? That doesn't seem right. Dio here is trying to negate that luck. And in some sense, it is a very noble aim, which is why the Part 6 Dio feels so distinct and weird. When you read him in Part 6, or I guess if you watch him in Part 6 as the anime comes out, whenever that comes out. But all the same, it is a logical place for Dio to have arrived at, especially looking at people like Undul, who, as the book describes, was completely isolated from the world because of the fact that he had his stand. Which again is just another arbitrary thing. Who decides that someone should have a stand? Who decides that someone is a taker or an inheritor? In another way, you could also look at this as setting up Dio's sons in Part 6, who in some sense are born evil, right? But they're also born as inheritors. They inherited Dio's legacy, Dio's plan for heaven. Right, and ultimately they are the ones who service Pucci for that plan. But then also, there is another son that Dio has, of course, from part 5. That's Giorno, who's definitely not evil in the most profoundest sense of the word, though he does immoral things. The whole point of part 5, more or less, is that his soul is oriented towards the good, despite what he has inherited from Dio. Before I get too far ahead of myself, I just wanted to finish up one final thing that I wanted to say about how parts 1 and 3 are being recapped, and that's the frustration that Dio has with, like, really small and petty elements of the past. For example, Whole Horse's defeat, when Whole Horse has the ability to control the bullets that he shoots from his stand gun, from his intangible mind-controlled gun, where he can shoot intangible mind-controlled bullets, the way he goes out is by shooting himself in the forehead. And Dio has to sit there and be like, I can't believe this is real. Holy fuck. So that was really fun, both to write when I was rewriting those particular entries, and also to perform, also to read out, just reading that frustration into it, being like, I don't blame Whole Horse because, you know, apparently Joestars have fate itself on their side, but seriously, dude, you shot yourself with a bullet that you can control with your mind. What is... The other time that happened was when Dio was talking about the techniques that he had in part 1 as a vampire, and he's listing out the names, and so he says, I had the vaporization freeze technique, which is what it's actually called, and I can freeze people by touching them and robbing them of all their warmth and turning their blood to ice so they can't run Hamon, etc., etc. And then he gets to his second technique, and he has to pause and be like, I didn't name it. It was some fucking Hamon user prick, all right? You can't judge me for this. Oh my god. And trying to get a clean take of Dio sitting there being like, it is called the Space Ripper Stingy Eyes Technique. So it was like a 5-minute battle against every impulse I had. And I had to exercise my sheer tyranny of will, as Norm MacDonald says, just to make sure that I got a very clean take. Anyway, let's go back to actually discussing the entries. I couldn't, in good conscience, finish this video without talking about the fact that it was Boingo who actually gave the idea to Dio, and ultimately to Pucci, that true heaven, or heaven on earth at least, is this idea that you have complete resolve to accept the future no matter what is presented to you. I think Boingo is the correct character to have that perspective, because unlike all of these other fortune-telling stands, like Epitaph, like Bites the Dust, Boingo alone has a stand that gives you the future but without giving you the ability to change it. The predictions are 100% accurate, as Boingo himself says all the time, right? That's his little catchphrase, as it were. And so, you know, a lot of you guys rightfully, I think, pointed out how crazy that is, how ridiculous it is that that is the case. Boingo specifically has a lot of weird things, like a lot of people have pointed out that Araki sort of predicted 9/11 in those particular panels where Boingo is involved. So, you know, like, woo, conspiracy theory and all that. But, you know, all that weirdness aside, I think, though it is appropriate for Boingo to have been the one, I think it is a little bit reachy, let's say, for Nisio Isin to have actually had Boingo straight up be the one to say it like that, and not Dio himself kind of reaching that conclusion by studying or by thinking about or exploring what Boingo's stand actually means. I think it is a very ballsy move for him to have said, yep, Boingo was the one. But hey, you know, one of the reasons why I enjoy thinking of these particular light novels, these ancillary novels to JoJo's Bizarre Adventure as fan works, is because we can see these new perspectives and not just be immediately upset at them for, you know, like messing with canon, but because we can think of them as though, you know, people are just sort of throwing ideas out and seeing what is fun in JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, seeing what is fun about JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, that there is a, you know, a fortune-telling stand over here can so beautifully set up the main villain stand of part 6. To be fair, it was slightly put off by the fact that he also saw similarities with Setan, you know, Alessi, the creepy axe murderer pedophile who can turn people into fetuses, creepiest stand in JoJo, by the way. Absolutely disgusting, repelling human that it belongs to. And also just the idea of turning into a fetus that is not like within a womb is just so, I don't want to think about it. That's just more nightmare fuel. I'm gonna escape from vampires and I'm gonna walk right into a baby. Which apparently is also the case in Resident Evil 8 Village. So all the more reason not to have purchased Resident Evil 8 Village. Right, so Setan, you know, the fact that Dio can still see parallels of his idea of heaven within Setan, I think speaks a bit more to the fact that Dio arrived to this conclusion on his own. And it wasn't just Boingo being like, hey, yeah, by the way, what do you think of this? And Dio being like, mind blown. Because if you think about this idea of heaven, it's a really bizarre idea, ultimately. The most interesting thing, you know, I've talked a lot about Christian ideas over these commentaries, so let me not make an exception here. For the majority of the text, Dio is thinking about heaven in a theological sense, where it is something that you reach after you die. Which is strange for a vampire to be considering in the first place. But with Boingo's revelation that to accept the future is heaven, Dio's perception of heaven changes from the transcendental, the immaterial, to the material. He is trying to bring heaven down to earth, which is another act of pride, as it were. You know, Jordan Peterson in Rule 11 specifically, if you guys want to go and check out that rule on my channel. In Rule 11, he specifically talks about the dangers of trying to generate heaven on earth through a, let's say, a forceful or an immature or a secular method, and how it can just as easily create a tyranny instead. Of course, you know, he mentions Mao and Stalin and Hitler and the classics, as it were, of trying to create totalitarian utopias. Totalitarian utopias. Not through some divine impulse toward the good, but instead the secular impulse towards solving the immediate problems at hand of the suffering that is inherent to being. And whether that's, you know, having to deal with tragedy the way that Pucci does, or, you know, going to a real world example of wealth inequality, right? Like, that's the central Marxist claim. And yeah, it can be pretty devastating to realize some people will live in absolute abject poverty for their entire lives, while people such as ourselves live in luxury, right? Like, we can sit here on our phones and we can listen to whatever. Like, that's a pretty significant thing. But in both the suffering of the real world and the suffering that Pucci is abject to, the attempt to create an immediate heaven to reduce or else otherwise, I guess, subvert the suffering of life is an inherently evil thing to do. The central claim, I guess, is the fact of your existence is tied to the fact of your suffering. There is no separating the two. All you can really do is to bear that cross. All right, so that's a nice little theological bow with which to tie that discussion. I will say, as a little, I guess, cliffhanger, or to whet your appetites for the final part, there is still one last detail of part 6 that still needs to be set up, so to speak, that still needs to be foreshadowed in Over Heaven. I wonder if you guys recognize what it is. And it amuses me because Pucci's plan for heaven in part 6 is so convoluted and so strange. It's almost Lovecraftian how he has to perform all these incomprehensible, strange rituals, like reciting the 14 words, like getting the 36 souls. And the entire justification for it is, it's in Dio's diary. And so it's been very funny to see Nisio Isin just sort of throwing all of these little details into the book as much as he can. And so right here in the last 6 entries, there is one little detail that he just kind of throws in. It's pretty much a bonus chapter that just says, oh, by the way, here's this one little detail that was also mentioned in part 6 that I totally forgot about. So here you go. So I'm really excited to read that for you guys. This has been really fun to record. I hope you guys had a lot of fun. If you guys enjoyed the video, this is me going full vlogger. Be sure to smash the like button, bang the notification gong so that you get gonged when you bang or something. And until next time, it's been your boy, Dargosian. What are the other vlog things I said I do? A makeup sesh? Oh, I guess I could...
Yeah, I guess I will.
People like you always want back the love they gave away. People like me want to believe you when you say you've changed. The more I think about it now, the less I know for sure. All I know is that you drove us off the road. All you had to do was stay. You had me in the palm of your hand. Then why'd you have to go and lock me out when I let you in? Now you say you want it back, now that it's just too late. Well, it could have been so easy. All you had to do was stay. All you had to do was stay. Yeah, 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 yeah. All you had to do was stay.
Stay.